here, Mr. True.
In this video, we are going to take the pre out of pre-calculus in our last chapter and start looking at some of the core concepts that you would learn in the first chapter of calculus if you take that next semester or next year. Now, in our textbook, we've had a couple of examples or areas where we've talked about limits. We've talked about, say, horizontal asymptotes, and where did the graph, you know, what value did the graph approach? What y values did the graph settle down to or approach as x went to infinity? Maybe horizontal asymptote is y equals 2, and the y values of the graph would come down and approach 2 from the top and become, you know, infinitely close to 2, but never exactly equal to 2. That's sort of a form of limits. We also had a chapter, I think it was chapter 2 for my textbook, that, you know, actually introduced limit notation, which we're going to review in this video as we find limits both graphically and numerically. It's a fairly simple material as far as the mechanics of the work for this particular introductory chapter or section. So I'm going to first do a couple of screens here and showing you or show you how the idea of limits are used in calculus. There's two core concepts you're going to learn. One is derivative and one is integration later on in the second half of your first year of or first semester of calculus. Okay, you might have in your pre-calc book this idea of a quotient rule, this formula of quotient rule. We reviewed it or were introduced to this formula when we were first learning or being reminded of function notation and reminded, like, you know, if it was f of 2, you take out the x and plug in 2, or if it was f of a plus 2, you took all the x's out and plugged in a plus 2, and they threw this formula in to help you practice relearning or reminding yourself of how that function notation worked. And I did a video on this, and basically because I knew it was going to come up in chapter 11, of this quotient rule. The reason why it was in your pre-calculus book is because, you know, f of something is fancy notation for y, so f of x plus h minus f of x mean you're subtracting two y values. Now, what equation did we learn that had a subtraction of two y values on top? Y sub 2 minus y sub 1 over x sub 2 minus x sub 1, but yet this denominator is only equal to h. Well, that's because some simplification has occurred. You know, how do you find this y value or this, you know, function value when you plug in? When you plug in, well, that must mean that x plus h is kind of acting as what I've learned in algebra 1 as my maybe x sub 1 or x sub 2. And then to get this y value, this function value, we plugged in x, and now we sort of have a fancy version of y sub 2 minus y sub 1 over x sub 2 minus x sub 1, and we know that is basically, or is, a version of slope. So you will be learning an idea soon called derivatives that is basically, when you find the derivative in calculus, you are finding a version of your original formula or equation that will allow you to find slope at any point. So here's a curved line, here's a fixed point on this curve, and you need two points to find slope. Even the quotient rule basically said that we needed two points. So maybe I'll put a point here, we'll call it x plus h and f of x plus h. So we've got a fixed point, another point based off of this point, and then there is some kind of unknown horizontal distance between those two points. And I'm going to use those two points to estimate the slope at that point. Well, this yellow line is not really estimating the slope at this point very well. So if I were to take the horizontal distance and reduce it, maybe let the point, the movable point, go to here and shrink my distance of h, well, now using those two points to estimate the slope at this point, my estimation is still not great, but it's certainly better than my yellow line. And then, if I were to move the point even closer, I would get a better estimation of the slope at that point, x, f of x, with the, you know, using the second point of x plus h, f of x plus h. So what calculus will allow you to do in this idea of limits that you're going to learn in this section is if you let h, the horizontal distance between your two points you're using to find slope, and you do need two points, But if you let that horizontal distance approach zero, let it approach zero as, you know, sort of it's a limit as x is approaching zero, then you're going to get a better and better estimation of the slope of this curved line. Calculus will be the first time, and actually we're going to do it in this chapter, this will be the first time you're going to be allowed to find or know how to find the slope of a curved line, which is really, really cool. So, you know, if we allow h to become zero, you know, because this denominator was originally h, because x minus x is zero, we can't actually divide by zero. So with calculus and this idea of limits, we're going to let that denominator approach zero, but not actually equal zero. Like basically, if this denominator is 0.00000000001, this fraction is still defined. So that's why we're learning an introduction to limits in this discussion, because it's going to allow us, with the old formula of slope that you learn in Algebra 1, along with this idea of a limit and allowing the distance between these two points to approach zero, calculus is going to allow us to find something called a derivative, which will allow us to find the slope of a curved line along any given point or along any given x value. Let's do one more example of why we need to know limits and then actually learn the concept. So on this board, I've got some diagrams drawn, three curves, and I have a bunch of rectangles drawn to these curves. Another idea you're going to learn, another key concept in calculus you're going to learn after you finish with the idea of the concept of derivatives, finding first and second derivatives, is you're going to then start trying to find areas under curves. And in calculus one, that'll be two-dimensional curves. Well, this is we would call this a right skew distribution in calculus. I could have drawn any shape. And we don't have area formulas for every single sort of unique curved shape. So what we do in calculus, when we start introducing this concept of integrals, is explain how basically we're going to find the areas of a bunch of small rectangles, which are, you know, just length times width, and add the areas of all those rectangles together to estimate the area of the curve. Now, which of these three drawings do you think is going to give us the best estimation of the area underneath this curve? And I've just tried to draw these curves again as equally as I could. Clearly, it's going to be the middle one with all the very, very small rectangles, because we have the least amount of error with the over and under estimation, or with this easier to see with this orange rectangle drawing. You know, when you draw rectangles to estimate the area of a curve, you're going to overestimate some areas and underestimate others, thus having an error. Well, in calculus, again, with this idea of a limit, we're going to learn with integration how we can take the widths of these rectangles and shrink them to have widths of approaching zero. So we're kind of going to be finding the area of an sort of an almost infinite number of rectangles to get what is kind of almost basically an infinitely accurate estimate of the area of the curve. So these are concepts are many, many months away, or at least many chapters away when you get into calculus. So I'm not going to try and explain how to do an integral, but this idea of a limit allowing w approach zero, the widths of the rectangles to approach, but not exactly equal zero, but approach zero, that idea will again allow us to do something called integration in calculus, and thus, you know, again, shows the importance of why we need to get a good understanding of what limits are in the next couple of sections of your calculus book or in pre-calc, where we find them both algebraically, numerically and graphically. So let's get the core concept defined and do some examples. Bang!